Before I start, let me congratulate Mr. Kapoor and that wonderful team of restorers, not for the actual work of restoration, which is a continuing process, but for the interest that Rotary and they have taken in a city in which most people seem to be losing interest rather fast. This restoration, it attracted my attention and will attract yours if you look in for a few signs. The portraiture or the painting of the Last Supper went through one of those paradigm shifts after the Renaissance. Before the Renaissance, the 12 apostles were around the table, so you saw the backs of six of them. Post-Renaissance, all of them are arranged in a circle or in a straight line. You don't have chairs on the front, because the Renaissance artists thought it best to show all of them together, though it's a little unnatural. This one brings in a circle, leaving just a space, so that is an innovation. It brings in both the pre- and post-Renaissance representations of the Last Supper. One of the very unique pictures I've seen. Now, coming to Calcutta, it's not very important whether this is a birthday or not, because the city can't be born on a particular day. It's not something that comes into existence on a certain day. The day is important for us to note, because that would lead to what I call a new settlement around this place. That's all. Now, most people know that on the 24th of August, 1690, Job Chanok came here, and thereafter a city came into birth. Let's get into what was troubling the Englishman and why he chose this particular spot. You transport yourself to the 1670s, 1680s, 1690s, and you'll get the picture. The British had just about asserted themselves, almost as a matter of fluke, as a naval power. As a naval power, and they were asserting themselves after the Armada. They were not accepted either as a naval power or as an army worth reckoning. British would be accepted as an army worth reckoning only after 1815, after the Battle of Waterloo, when Wellington led the Allied command and happened to be on the winning side. The most historians know that it was Marshal Blucher or Blucher who played a much bigger role. Now, coming back to 1690, what the Brits had and the others didn't have was a growing navy that had ships broad enough to take on the recoil of powerful cannons. So what do you need to assert your supremacy? There's a Bengali proverb that says that if the crocodile wants to show you its might, it doesn't fight you with you on land. It invites you into the water. Okay? So something very similar. All the foreign powers were on the west bank of the Hooghly. Fort Gustavus was in Chinsura and almost impregnable. That was the Dutch. Serampore was with the French. Bandal had been with the Portuguese, from which you get Bandal cheese, from which you'll get paneer and chana and the Bengali sweets. But the English presence was only in Hooghly. It moved on to capture Bandal, but that was secondary. The point is, on that side of the river, you were more susceptible to the Mughal Fauzdar and his minions. At any point of time, the Fauzdar of Hooghly would pounce upon you, extract his chanda, and move away. The Mughal emperor had given a firman for giving them trading rights for a magnificent sum of rupees 3,000. But that was not respected by the local Fauzdar, who behaved like a local thanedar whenever he felt like, and he would be extorting money. More than that, the other powers would connive with the remnants of the Mughal regime. And this led to an exasperation that most traders within these communities had. So Chanak came up with this brilliant idea that if I have a stretch of water between me and everyone else, whoever steps on the water, I can blow him out to smithereens. That is a central idea of coming to this bank. Why this particular spot? It could have been further north. It could have been further south. In fact, the logical place was Hijli or Falta. Falta is the place where Ultimatic Live would be landing. He chose this spot because this was the maximum extent to which the seagoing vessel could come and rest. After this, it became treacherous because of the sandbars. You didn't know how far you could go. Being a very calculating man, he chose Sutanetti because in low tide, there's a lot of water there, and it's called Sutanetti Deep. In the English records, it's known as Chutanetti Deep. Even if you kept your boat there, in low tide, it would not get stuck in the mud, whereas it would get stuck here. So all these calculations are written in the books of the East India Company, otherwise known as the consultations of the Right Honorable East India Company. So on 1686, in 1686, Chanak was made the factor at Hooghly. Factor incidentally meant the chief merchant, the guy who was just above chief merchant. And the unit around a factor was a trading outpost that was known as the factory. The factory does not start as a production unit. It starts as a trading unit. Below the factor would be chief merchants, senior merchants, writers, underwriters. We have left behind one of these appellations in one of the houses quite close to here, the writers. So Chanak had made his, he was made Fauzdar, and he was an impetuous man. He was earlier factor at Patna, from which the British procured saltpeter. Saltpeter was an essential mineral that was used for gunpowder. He realized the exasperation of dealing with a decaying empire of the Mughals. He was sent at Qasim Bazar, he picked up fights. He went to Hooghly and he picked up a massive row. In 1686, Chanak's men fought it out with the soldiers of the Mughals. After massacring, I think, 17 of them, the Mughals had enough. They started firing on them. Chanak would retreat in 1686 to Chutanetti, take a little rest. By that time, company had enough of him. This guy and his maverick techniques, and he was reported to be staying with an Indian lady. Chanak incidentally was fond of wearing Indian dresses, and this is where he stands out. He realized that this sticky climate required a loose flowing dress, not the very tight breeches. So Chanak with his lady wife were for that moment very unpopular where the English company was concerned. And one of his company rivals, many of us who worked in companies or in government know what rivalry means. He was knocked off and he was told to take charge of Chittagong, knowing fully well that Chittagong was a place where you couldn't penetrate because of the tough resistance being offered by the locals, warlike locals. Now, between Chittagong and Hooghly, this tete-a-tete had gone on for almost a century from the time of the Portuguese. In fact, the Portuguese called one Porto Picono, the small port, and Porto Grande, the big port. This had gone on, this had been going on. So Chanak decided that he actually made a try at Chittagong. He couldn't, came back here, occupied Hijli. Where is Hijli? Any idea? Kharagpur. It's IIT Kharagpur. That's Hijli. The river had come up to that part those days. So he had tried Hijli. He couldn't make his felt. He went down from Hijli. Hijli incidentally was the second choice for the setting up of the empire, for setting up the city. From Hijli, he moved down to Balasore. He knew Balasore rather well. So he said, I'll take my shot at Balasore. got second tired of Balasore, was posted again to Fort St. George, Madras. At Madras, he was not happy. So after 3 years, his rival, Captain Heath was replaced, and in 1690, Chanak was sent back to Hooghly. 1690 just takes him a few months to get into scraps again, bar brawls, and he had, this time, he was more mentally prepared. He ordered his ships to be in readiness, and after the first brawl, he decided to think ahead of the company. The guns I told you, the ships I told you, is all in his mind. On the first brawl, he decides, he comes back to Chutanati and camps. So Chutanati was not an accident. Chutanati's location is exactly today Nimtala. He had thatched houses there. He required pakka construction because it was raining like hell, 4 days of rain. So he came over here and made a deal with the Savarna Rai Chaudhary family and bought up the Kacheri house at Dihi, Kolkata. Or rather, it was known, Kolkata was only a revenue name. This was known as Lal Dighi. This was the only source of fresh water that they had. Fort William that would be built here, not there. Fort William, the first Fort William, is where the GPO is. If you go close to the GPO, you will see this is a spot in which Fort William existed. Now here comes Chanak, takes it up. What's so great about having a sheet of water? What about being attacked from the back? You have the option. There was no way. The entire part of Calcutta, eastern part of Calcutta, was flooded with marsh, salt water marshes. And that is why the township that we have reclaimed is known as Salt Lake City. So on the other hand, you had salt marshes. On the western bank, you had the water. There's a thin strip of land that goes along the Hooghly. All you need to position is 4 cannons. You could take care of that rest. The thin strip. One major problem with the site selection. I mean, it had a lot of problems. One major problem was, normally the drainage of a city, it tilts toward the river so that the water flows into the river. Calcutta has just the reverse. The Hooghly bank is higher, and then it slopes into the salt lakes. What happens when it rains? I don't need to ask in Calcutta. What happens when it rains? There's no way we can throw it out. So what the British did was to put in diagonal pipes and pump the water in into the Hooghly. So there are a series of gates known as water gates. So that was the reason for the selection. And let's move fast forward. Chanak dies 2 years later. He's succeeded by Sir Charles Iyer and goes on. But what about the rest of the city? It's too long a history to tell you. But let me tell you how Calcutta would be defined. After these 3 villages, I've talked of one, Nimtala Ghat, Mohantos Ghat. I've talked of the second, Kolkata, that is Dalhousie Square. Where's the third? Govindapur. Govindapur was another star attraction for Chanak, because as a trader, he needed a trading community to act as Dobhashi. He had to have somebody who was not a Brahmin or a Kayastha, someone who could talk trade. And here were 4 families settled in Govindapur, Seth, Bosak, Sheel, and Malik. They were traders. Till 1856, the major base of Calcutta's, the major fortification of Calcutta was what you call the GPO, Fort William. 1756, Shiraz, who's then Nawab of Bengal, decides to come down and take clash with the British. They had just grown a bit too much. From 1690 to 1756, Shiraz ud-Daulah comes in and meets the first combat at a place that was famous for trade. It's at Sialdah. The name of the place is Baitakkhana. It's this Baitakkhana which continues to remain one of the main trading marts of Calcutta. If people who have seen Irimala Dushan want to see Calcutta by night, early morning, if you want to see how trading is done with huge trucks of fishes, huge trucks carrying fruits and vegetables, come off to Baitakkhana at 4 o'clock in the morning. It's at Baitakkhana that you had this banyan tree under which sat the Baniya, the trader, who wore a very loose garment which would later on be known as Baniyan, the one that we wear. It's a loose sort of a cotton garment. So 1756, Shiraduddullah's troops come in and take the first battle at Baitakkhana, Sialdah. I think that was the first traffic jam we had. After that, they move along this road. And they came up to a point up to near Lal Bazaar, where today's Lal Bazaar is, and started bombarding. The first major edifice that was under attack, guess which? Next to Writer's Building is a thin steeple, tall steeple of a church. That church didn't exist in that form. It was a ballroom in the evening and a courthouse in the morning. The Brits didn't want two buildings. So that is why when you come in from Raj Bhavan side, it's called Old Courthouse Street, right at that point. So this courthouse got smashed. Writer's Building didn't exist, so there's no point in smashing, but I guess there are lots of people who could have a lot of number of views about what to do with it. So it moved on, and they started bombarding the fort. The fort being GPO, forget the GPO, the fort was there. They damaged the fort, and after that you have the story of Holwell's dark hole. Okay, move on. 1757 comes a maverick called Robert Clive. He lands up again from Fort St. George. Fort St. George has an irritating way of sending people to Calcutta. So he lands up there and he moves on. At Falta, he's told by the East India Company's men not to undertake further adventures. Moves on. He tears up the message and moves further towards Calcutta, occupies Calcutta, smashes Sirajuddullah, moves up to attack him. He had by that time worked it out with Mirzafar. And they meet in a village which is on the borders of Murshidabad and Nadia, Plassey. The rest is history. What happens after Plassey is very interesting. With the war compensation that the British gave him, they decide to build a new fort. So this fort is now removed from the Dalhousie Square area and taken to the village of Gobindapur and wiped off. The village of Gobindapur is wiped off. Go to Fort William and you'll see written next to it, under it lies the village of Govindapur. This village would be converted into Fort William. Now Fort William is one of the books in the book of Guinness Book of World Records as one of the largest forts in the world from which a shot has never been fired in anger. All shots are ceremonial. But let me tell you about a few shots. How do the British ensure that they aren't licked again and again? So they point their guns. Incidentally, again, the gun that they got was not from Calcutta, Fort St. George. They mounted it on top of Fort William and fired it all around. Wherever it fell on the east side, habitations were razed to the ground. And that wide green would be known by the company's soldiers from the Purvia, Ara, Balia, Chapra, as the Maidan. But the Bengalis would call it Goder Mat. Nothing would be allowed to grow in this so as not to get into the way of sight of the cannons. Go on. Now, a problem was, by 1742, a new guy had appeared on the scene called the Marathas. The Marathas were desperate. And to control the Marathas, the British decided to build a huge ditch, because the Marathas were light cavalry, and the light cavalry couldn't cross over a deep moat. The moat started at Khidapore, went around in a perfect circle around Calcutta, and joined at north of Calcutta. It became a D. The moat couldn't become a perfect half circle, a perfect D. Halfway in this place called Maniktala, they were stopped. What story is Maniktala? They were stopped. Lots of people stopped the work and said, why are we made to stay outside the fort? We also want to be part of the fort area, the protected area. So Maniktala is split into two. One part gets into the fort, that is east of Circular Road. The other part is still known as Gadpad. That's your outside. Calcutta has this fascinating history as it goes along. This ditch would be known as the Great Circular Ditch, which would become the Great Circular Road. Circular Road. This road becomes the original jurisdiction of Calcutta. Till today, if you slap a guy near Victoria Memorial, you'd be taken to the Calcutta court of the Chief Metropolitan Magistrate. He would be known as Chief Presidency Magistrate, Chief Metropolitan Magistrate. If you slap a guy on the other side, you're taken to Alipur Court, because you are in District South 24 Paragonas. How do you join the two? Now, the Chief Metropolitan Magistrate's Court had the jail near Harinbari. From Harinbari, near Lal Bazar, it would be shifted down south. And when Victoria Memorial would come up, the jail would have to be shifted outside Calcutta. When you talk of Calcutta, you mean the original jurisdiction of Calcutta, the circle. One minor problem. British law says that no magistrate can execute a sentence outside his jurisdiction. How do you get this new court and new jail in Alipur, Presidency Jail, how do you get it to be part of Calcutta? If you look back into old Calcutta's history, you'll see Calcutta has a little tail coming out near Victoria Memorial. That's called D.L. Khan Road. And it goes on and tags along with Presidency Jail. So Calcutta is a D with a little tail, because unless you brought it within Calcutta, you couldn't sentence a man. Move. Why? What would be some of the distinguishing marks of Calcutta? One of them would be that there were two primordial cults, primitive cults of Bengal, that left their mark behind. Calcutta was famous for Kali Ghat. In any case, people had to go along the pilgrim's path to Kali Ghat. And when you entered into the domain of Calcutta, people normally rested at a resting place attached to a Nath monastery or Nath place of worship. This Nath worship, place of Nath, was known after Chaurangi Baba. So those who know the Nath cult would know about Chaurangi Baba, who gave the name of Chaurangi Road. But along with that, some would prefer to come in from Boitakhana side, and they would stop at a mandir of Dharma Thakur, Dharmatala. So you now have the x-axis and y-axis of Calcutta. But Calcutta had more interesting tales. With the rate of mortality, this fellow lasted 2 years, his daughter 2 years after founding, there was a high rate of mortality. And by that time, the schisms within the English settlement had come up to the fore. With the war compensation that Chanak got, he was supposed to repair. This was the first English church, St. John's. The Scots came up and said, where is our church? So with the war compensation, the Scots got their church, which was where the old courthouse was, which is known as St. Andrew's Kirk. Kirk, not church. Go and see it. It's St. Andrew's Kirk. The Scots had a lot of presence in Calcutta, as names like Russell, Grant. You go along the names of Calcutta and you find the contribution of the Scots. The Scots and English used to have a little bit of fisticuffs after a couple of drinks. Never mind. Where do you bury? By that time, along with the English Protestants, there were leftovers of the Roman Catholic Church. The Portuguese had left behind so many Catholics. And Protestant Catholics had just got out of their exciting phase. So we needed a place to bury. And a place to bury was required a substantial place to bury. So bodies would be carried on from this Gur area, the fort area, and taken straight along to the near the ditch, where you still have both the Protestant and the Catholic burial grounds. The road that connected them was known as the burial ground road. This burial ground road would later on be converted into a park. A huge park, because burial ground sounds so ominous. And the only little slice of the park that we have, and park and manor that we have, is Loretta House. Loretta House is the only patch of green, and Allen's garden, that little patch of green, is the only thing we have left out of Park Street, leading to Middleton's house. That's why it's Middleton Street. So each street of Calcutta this way reeks of a past, reeks of history. This is one city that is soaked in history. So this is a city that had its trigger point today, 1690, on a hot, sticky, rainy day. Right from its birth, it learned to take criticism in its stride. And one of the most virulent critics of Calcutta was Rudyard Kipling. Kipling was a Lahori, and he believed that Bengalis were not very exciting people, and Calcutta was a mistake. So this is Kipling's tribute to Calcutta, backhanded and smashy. Let me conclude with this little thing that he has left behind. Does the midday halt of Chanak, more's the pity, grew a city. As a fungus sprouts chaotic from its bed, so it spread. Chance directed, chance erected, laid and built on this silt. Paris, palace, buyer, hovel, poverty and pride, side by side, and up to here it's tolerable. And above, it's descriptive. But here is where Kipling gives his punchline. And above the packed and pestilential town, death looks down. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give Kipling a big lie. We shall going on looking at death in the face, looking at adversities in the face, and we shall be here celebrating the centenary, these 300 years, 500 years, 700 years, maybe from this building itself. We don't know. Calcutta has something that very few cities of the world have, a spirit to fight and live. With these words, I thank you for your patience, and God bless you.